For everything there is a season, a time for every purpose under heaven. And so it was that the one who held the very hands of time chose to release his grip on eternity and become obedient to the seasons of human existence. As you contemplate the seasons of Christ's life through this music, may you gain clarity and peace for your own journey of faith. For everything, there is a season and a time for every purpose under heaven. As we celebrate our new life in Christ, may we discover our purpose as instruments of praise. This is the time for Alleluia. To everything there is a season and a time for every purpose under heaven, a time to be born and a time to die. So it was in the life of Christ. From the beginning he had known the seasons of his Father's purpose. Soon the season of birth and growth would end, and the righteous branch once held by a wooden manger would die within the cruel embrace of a tree.
And the child grew up like a tender branch before the Lord, a strong young man. Jesus was respected by those around him. He amazed them with a wisdom beyond their understanding, and God's pleasure was upon him.
Isaiah spoke these words, a voice of one calling in the desert, build up, prepare a smooth and straight way for the Lord.
Thank you. "The time has come," he said. "The kingdom of God is near. Repent and believe the good news." He began calling others to follow him. Peter, his brother Andrew, James, and John were among the first. Leaving their families and livelihoods, they followed Jesus throughout Galilee. His ministry grew as he taught in the synagogues and preached, and word of his reputation as a healer spread. Soon, large crowds from the regions were gathered to him and began to follow wherever he went.
Took his disciples to Jerusalem. Large crowds lined the roads, spreading their coats and tree branches before him. Some people ran ahead, while others followed behind him, shouting, "Save us! Blessed are you, our King, and the kingdom you bring." As they entered the gates, the whole city began to ask, "Who is the cause of all this excitement?" The crowds answered, "Jesus, the prophet." But some of the religious leaders said to Jesus, "Teacher, tell the crowds to be quiet." He answered, "It is useless to deny them. If they are silent, the rocks themselves will cry out." And the leaders said to each other, "This is getting us nowhere. Look, the whole world seems to be following him."
Thank you. The chief priests and the elders met with the high priest and plotted to arrest Jesus and kill him. But not until after the Passover feast, they said, or there might be a riot among the people. Jesus knew that the time had come for him to leave the world and go to the Father. After celebrating Passover with his disciples, he took them to an olive garden named Gethsemane. In the darkness, he knelt down and prayed, "Father, the time has come. If there is no other way for your purpose to be accomplished, then I will do what you ask of me." With great anguish over what was about to happen, he prayed alone in the darkness. There was no comfort for his sorrow.
One of the 12, Judas, had offered to betray Jesus to the priests. In return, they agreed to pay him in silver. He waited for an opportunity to hand Jesus over to them, a time when no crowd was present. Now Judas knew of Gethsemane because Jesus had often met there with his disciples. So he came to the grove with a detachment of soldiers and religious officials. Jesus turned to his disciples and said, "The time has come. Look, my betrayer is here." Carrying torches, lanterns, and weapons, the soldiers seized Jesus and arrested him.
Soldiers come. After the arrest, the disciples fled as Jesus was taken to Caiaphas. Jesus had told them, "This very night you all will fall away, for it is written, 'I will strike the shepherd, and the sheep will be scattered.'" But Peter followed at a distance, right up to the courtyard. As he sat down with the guards, a servant girl came to him. "You also were with Jesus," she said, but he denied it before them all. Then he went out to the gate, where another girl saw him and said to the people, "This fellow was with Jesus of Nazareth." Peter denied it again. "I don't know the man." After a while, those standing around him said, "Surely you are one of them. Your accent gives you away." And he swore to them, "I tell you, I don't know the man." Immediately, he heard the cry of a rooster. It was early morning, and the chief priests and the elders came to the decision to put Jesus to death.
Jesus was then brought before Pilate, and soon an angry crowd gathered outside the governor's palace. Pilate asked them, "What shall I do with Jesus?" The people all answered, "Crucify him." And Pilate asked, "Why? What crime has he committed?" But they shouted all the louder, "Crucify him." Pilate told the crowd, "His blood is your responsibility." So Jesus was crucified as a criminal, as one who had done wrong. When he knew that all things had been completed for the Father's purpose, he cried, "It is finished," and he died. Emptying his life into death, his blood was poured out for our sins. our sins, our responsibility, for we share in Judas's greed and Peter's fear. We are guilty of Pilate's weakness and the Pharisees' envy and the mob's anger. We must look on the one we have pierced, and we too must mourn.
Thank you.
To everything there is a season and a time for every purpose under heaven, a time to plant and to uproot, to build and to tear down, a time to gather and to scatter, to love and to hate, a time to weep and to laugh, a time to be born and to die, a time to mourn and a time to dance. There is a time for Bethlehem and Golgotha, Gloria and Kyrie. This is the season for dancing, the time for Alleluia.